Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Leading with Questions: How Leaders Discover Powerful Answers by Knowing How and What to Ask, 3rd edition, by Michael J. Marquardt and Bob Tiede, narrated by Stephen Bell Davies. Introduction to the 3rd edition. Do you feel that people aren't providing the information you need? Do you wonder whether the people in your unit really understand your vision for where things need to go? Do you speculate about what your boss is really thinking? Have you ever thought about getting all this information and more by asking questions? Questions can elicit information, of course, but they can do so much more. Astute leaders use questions to encourage full participation and teamwork, to spur innovation and outside-the-box thinking, to empower others, to build relationships with customers, to solve problems, to develop leadership skills, and to change organizations and communities, as we will show in this book. Recent research and the experience of a growing number of organizations are now concluding that the most successful leaders lead with questions and use questions more frequently. Successful and effective leaders create the conditions and environment to ask and be asked questions. When the Center for Creative Leadership studied nearly 200 successful executives, researchers discovered that the key to the executive's success was asking questions and creating opportunities for others to ask questions. Consider these successful leaders. Chad Holliday, chairman of the board and CEO of DuPont. I find that when someone engages me in a question, it wakes me up. I'm in a different place. Throughout the day, I try to do the same thing. I ask questions. I rarely make statements until I have sized up the person's energy and focus, and whether they are open-minded. Only then can I move. If I don't ask questions, I could be underrating the situation and problem and miss the key issues. Michael Dell, founder of Dell Inc. Asking lots of questions opens new doors to new ideas, which ultimately contributes to your competitive edge. That's why you must encourage the free flow of information at all levels. Penti Shadanmalaka, Director of Human Resources at Nokia Networks. Leading with questions has been always part of my leadership because I believe that leadership is not telling, but inspiring and showing others new places where they haven't been earlier. Eric Schmidt, co-founder of Google. We run this company on questions, not on answers. Robert Hoffman, executive director for organization development at Novartis. Questions have changed me immensely. I have greater self-confidence and a more relaxed attitude. I don't feel that I always have to have the answers in conversations or in situations where I need to speak on the spur of the moment. I feel this has increased my communications skills, especially listening and persuading. These leaders have discovered the amazing power of questions. Questions wake up people. They prompt new ideas. They show people new places, new ways of doing things. They help us admit that we don't know all the answers. Questions build great people, great organizations, and great communities. Unfortunately, many leaders are unaware of the amazing power of questions and how they can generate short-term results and long-term learning and success. If you have never considered making questions a tool in your leadership kit, this book is for you. Of course, many leaders do ask questions, but unfortunately, disempowering questions such as these. Why are you behind schedule? Who isn't keeping up? What's the problem with this project? Whose idea was that? Too often, we ask questions that disempower rather than empower our subordinates. These questions cast blame. They are not genuine requests for information. Other sorts of questions are often really just thinly veiled attempts at manipulation. Don't you agree with me on that? Aren't you a team player? If you tend to ask these sorts of questions, this book is for you. So the point isn't that we just don't ask enough questions. Often we don't ask the right questions. Or we don't ask questions in a way that will lead to honest and informative answers. Many of us don't know how to listen effectively to answers to questions, and haven't established a climate in which asking questions is encouraged. And that's where this book comes in. The purpose of leading with questions is to help you become a stronger leader by learning how to ask the right questions effectively, how to listen effectively, and how to create a climate and culture in which asking questions becomes as natural as breathing. Research on and with leaders who lead with questions. Both of us have spent our careers training managers all over the world, more recently developing leaders who ask questions. Mike was a global leadership consultant for 20 years and then served as professor for the executive leadership program at George Washington University for over 30 years. Bob has served in a variety of positions at Crew and is currently managing the organization's senior leadership program. His biweekly blog, Leading with Questions, recently celebrated its 10th anniversary. Over these many years, we have noted more and more frequently that leaders of the more successful companies tend to question others and themselves more often. We have made a concentrated effort to discover why questions are so important to leaders, why they result in such success, and what questions are the most powerful and used most frequently. Among the questions that we asked of the 45 leaders highlighted in this book, when did you start using questions and why? What are some of the ways in which you use questions? What questions have been most effective? What has been the impact of leading through questions on A, your organization, and B, you as a leader? How has the use of questions changed you as a leader? Their responses to these questions and their stories are interwoven throughout the third edition. As you listen to this book, you will discover the wisdom of the question-asking leaders. Among those who shared their experiences as questioning leaders are senior executives from DuPont, Marriott, Popeye's Chicken, Alcoa, Box of Crayons, Novartis, and Cargill. Public leaders from global and national agencies coming from every corner of the world, including Brazil, Finland, Malaysia, the United Kingdom, Mauritius, South Korea, Canada, Norway, Switzerland, Singapore, and the United States. We also sought out the latest and best research on questions from many of the leading authorities and gurus in the world. What's new in the third edition? There are many exciting differences and additions to the third edition of Leading with Questions. First, we have a wonderful new co-author, Bob Tiede, who is a leading advocate, practitioner, and author in the field of questions. His blog, Leading with Questions, began just before the second edition was written. Over the past 10 years, there have been over 1,000 posts guest-written by over 500 leaders and authors in the areas of questioning and leadership. We both continue to identify and admire great questioning leaders. 15 additional leaders were interviewed for this edition and have been added to the 30 who were highlighted in the second edition. The wisdom of these new leaders on how to increase the power and impact of questions is integrated throughout this edition. The impact of the pandemic worldwide between 2020 and 2022 has made work life more virtual. This edition explores the latest and best research and practices for asking questions in this new environment. Research on how to ask questions, what questions to ask, the skills of great questioners, and the use of questions in diverse settings and situations. Over the past 10 years, there has also been new research and ideas on the best ways for developing questioning leaders, especially the advancements in action learning, which is described in Resource B. Key aspects of leading with questions. This book is composed of 3 parts. In part 1, we explain why questions can be so powerful for individuals and organizations. Chapter 1 examines why leaders often prefer to provide answers rather than ask questions, and how limiting and disastrous that can be. We show why questioning is actually the ultimate leadership tool. Chapter 2 details the benefits for leaders and organizations of creating a question-friendly organizational culture. A questioning culture strengthens individual and organizational learning, improves decision-making, problem-solving, and teamwork, promotes adaptability and acceptance of change, and helps empower people by strengthening self-awareness and self-confidence. Part 2 offers practical guidance on asking questions effectively. Chapter 3 explains the stumbling blocks many of us face in asking questions and tells the stories of several leaders who have overcome them and benefited enormously. Chapter 4 shows how effective questions are empowering, while ineffective questions disempower, offers a thorough analysis of different types of questions, and describes the roots of great questions. Chapter 5 explores the art of asking questions effectively, examining how one's attitude, mindset, pace, and timing all affect the impact of asking questions. As this chapter demonstrates, active listening and following up are integral parts of the art of asking questions. Chapter 6 turns from the personal level to the organizational, offering detailed advice on fostering an organizational culture that is conducive to questions. Part 3 presents guidelines for leaders on using questions to achieve specific results for individuals, teams, and organizations. Chapter 7 discusses how leaders can use questions in managing their staff, strengthening relationships with direct reports, helping them grow, and encouraging action and innovative thinking. This chapter also reviews the use of questions in orienting new staff, setting goals and objectives, conducting performance appraisals, and leading staff meetings, among other topics. Chapter 8 describes how leaders can use questions to improve team functioning, energize team meetings, solve problems, help teams overcome obstacles, and resolve conflict. Chapter 9 explores how and why questions can be effective in solving problems. Chapter 10 shows how questioning can strengthen entire organizations, sharpening strategy, vision, and values, and building the capacity for change, focusing on questions with both internal and external stakeholder groups. The conclusion encourages and guides the listener to begin the journey to become a questioning leader. There are resources included in the book. Resource B describes how and why action learning programs are the most effective way to build great questioning leaders. A new level of leadership. Leaders who lead with questions will create a more humane workplace as well as a more successful business. Leaders who use questions can truly empower people and change organizations. Most leaders are unaware of the potential of questions and needlessly engage in a fractious, pressure-filled existence. Our hope is that listeners will change their style of leading and be more successful and fulfilled as leaders. There is no doubt that all of us, especially those of us who are leaders, need to ask more questions. Questions that will assist in the development of individuals, teams, organizations, and ourselves. Questions have become essential for our success. Poor leaders rarely ask questions of themselves or others. Good leaders, on the other hand, ask many questions. Great leaders ask great questions. And asking great questions can help you become a great leader. Part 1. The Power of Questions. Chapter 1. A Powerful but Underused Leadership Tool. We live in a fast-paced, demanding, results-oriented world. New technologies place vast quantities of information at our fingertips in nanoseconds. We want problems solved instantly, results yesterday, and answers immediately. We are exhorted to forget ready, aim, fire, and to shoot now and shoot again. Leaders are expected to be decisive, bold, charismatic, and visionary, to know all the answers before others have even thought of the questions. Ironically, if we respond to these pressures, or believe the hype about visionary leaders that is so prominent in the business press, we risk sacrificing the very thing we need to lead effectively. When the people around us clamor for fast answers, sometimes any answer, We need to be able to resist the impulse to provide solutions and instead learn to ask questions. Most leaders are unaware of the amazing power of questions, how they can generate short-term results and long-term learning and success. The problem is that we feel that we are supposed to have answers, not questions. Over the past 35 years, we have interviewed leaders around the world about their use, or avoidance, of questions. This comment from Gidget Hoff, President and CEO of the Association for the Blind and Visually Impaired, Goodwill Industries, is typical. I just automatically assumed that if someone was at my door with a problem, they expected me to solve it. Hoff thought it was her job to provide answers. Then she realized that there was another more effective way. Through coaching, I realized how disempowering this is, and how much more effective I could be by posing the question back to the individual with the problem. What I came to realize is that solving others' problems is exhausting. It is much more effective to provide the opportunity for them to solve their own problems. Unfortunately, from an early age, we are discouraged from asking questions, especially challenging ones, be it at home, school, or at church, as they are considered rude, inconsiderate, or intrusive. Thus, we become fearful of asking any questions. As we ask fewer questions, we become ever less comfortable and competent in asking questions. And then, when we become leaders, we feel that it is important for us to have answers rather than questions, or that asking questions, or being unable to answer questions addressed to us, may show that we are somehow lacking as leaders. But this attitude leads to inertia. Consider what Jeff Carew, a vice president at Collect Corp, told us. The easy way to lead, particularly if you are competent at your job, is to tell people how to do things in the way you have been successful. Usually, as Jeff has observed, people become successful either through a very capable boss who taught them the ropes, or through their experiential learning that resulted in a successful track record and steady career advancement. Successful executives think they know the answers. The problem with this, Jeff noted, is that if you do not create and maintain a working environment where you are always asking questions of your employees and forcing them to think, then you will probably never be any better tomorrow than you are today. Yesterday's solutions will not solve tomorrow's problems. I learned that you need to get a different level of thinking if you are going to tackle tomorrow's problems. And who else is better to teach you how your environment is changing than the managers on the floor or in the trenches? Like Jeff Carew, a growing number of leaders recognize that their organization's success, if not their survival, depends upon creating a learning organization, an organization that is able to quickly adapt to the changing environment, where every engagement becomes a learning opportunity, where learning and business objectives are necessarily interlinked. The ability to ask questions goes hand in hand with the ability to learn. A learning organization is only possible if it has a culture that encourages questions. Gary Cohen, author of Just Ask Leadership, rightly observed that it is not possible for leaders in the 21st century to be a know-it-all. Nor is it in their or the organization's best interest to try. It is more important that leaders ask questions that move others to action and answers. We should recognize that the employees who work for you today probably know more than you do about their job. And as leaders move up the ranks of an organization, they will undoubtedly end up leading people who perform tasks that the leader will not understand. Mike Stice, CEO of Access Midstream Partners, said to me, "I need to continually ask questions to become part of the organization. Questions enable me to increase alignment, engagement, and accountability. And it is not simply asking more questions, it is asking more and better questions." Do you feel defensive when people ask you questions? Do you ever hesitate to ask a question, fearing that it may reveal ignorance or doubt? If so, you are closing off the free flow of information and ideas your organization needs, and potentially undermining relationships with those around you. In fact, avoiding questions can cause serious harm, even disaster. What happens when leaders do not ask questions? History is replete with tales of dire consequences experienced by leaders who did not ask questions. Disasters at companies such as Lehman Brothers, Kodak, Barclays, Blockbuster, Enron, Borders, and Arthur Andersen can be attributed to the lack of inquiring leaders. Historians who carefully examined the events and details behind the disasters of the Titanic, the Challenger, and the Bay of Pigs have determined a common thread: the inability or unwillingness of participants and leaders to raise questions about their concerns. Some group members were fearful that they were the only one who had a particular concern, when in fact it was later discovered that many people in the group had similar concerns. Others felt that their question had already been answered in the minds of other group members, and if they asked the question, it would be considered a dumb one, and they would be put down as being stupid or not going along with the group. Because people did not ask questions, people lost lives when the Titanic sank, when the Challenger crashed, and when President Kennedy authorized a covert attack on the Bay of Pigs in Cuba. Sinking of the Titanic. Why did the Titanic sink? When the luxury ship went down on April 14, 1912, more than 1,400 passengers perished. Afterward, many questions were raised on both sides of the Atlantic. How could the allegedly unsinkable ship go down on its maiden voyage across the North Atlantic? What had gone wrong? Why couldn't the planner and builders have foreseen such a tragedy? Upon investigation, it was discovered that several of the planners and builders of the ship had indeed been concerned, although none of them had ever raised their concerns in the company of their colleagues. Why not? Because of their fear of appearing foolish by asking dumb questions. If no other expert seemed unsure about the structure and safety of the ship, then everything must be okay. Once the voyage was underway, many reports came in from nearby ships describing icebergs around them. Titanic received many incoming messages warning of ice. Robert E. Mittelstadt writes in Will Your Next Mistake Be Fatal? But there is no mention of her inquiring of others for updates or more information. What if someone was curious enough to ask for more information from the ships in the area? The explosion of the Challenger spacecraft. The space shuttle Challenger was launched on January 28, 1986, and exploded 73 seconds after liftoff. Much of the research into what went wrong with the Challenger launch focuses on the lack of communication among NASA, Morton Thiokol Inc., MTI, and the Marshall Space Center. MTI was the contractor responsible for the component that failed during the launch, and depended on Marshall for the contract, and Marshall depended on NASA for funding and support. Almost 2 years before the fatal launch, MTI became aware that there could be a problem with the O-ring, a sealing component that prevents hot gases from escaping the solid rocket booster and burning a hole in the fuel tank, the physical cause of the Challenger disaster. The engineers at MTI documented this problem and insisted that further testing needed to be done to determine the reliability of the O-ring. Upon further testing, they confirmed that the O-ring was not reliable, particularly when temperatures dropped below 53 degrees. Why, then, was the Challenger given the go to launch on January 28, 1986, when the temperature at launch time was 36 degrees, well below the safety margin? The people around the table were afraid to express their doubts or even to ask the questions that they had determined before entering the room that morning that they would ask. The 1961 Bay of Pigs invasion. Fears of shattering the warm feelings of perceived unanimity, of rocking the boat, kept some of Kennedy's advisors from objecting to the Bay of Pigs plan before it was too late. "How could I have been so stupid?" President John F. Kennedy asked after the Bay of Pigs fiasco. What happened? In 1961, the CIA and U.S. military leaders wanted to use Cuban exiles to overthrow Fidel Castro. After lengthy consideration among his top advisors, Kennedy approved a covert invasion. Advance press reports alerted Castro to the threat. More than 1,400 invaders arrived at the Bahia de Cochinos, Bay of Pigs, to find themselves vastly outnumbered. Lacking air support, necessary ammunition, and an escape route, nearly 1,200 surrendered. Others died. Top CIA leaders blamed Kennedy for not authorizing vital airstrikes. Other CIA analysts fault the wishful thinking that the invasion would stimulate an uprising among Cuba's populace and military. Planners assumed the invaders could simply fade into the mountains for guerrilla operations. Trouble was, 80 miles of swampland separated the bay from the mountains. The list goes on. Groupthink was the term Irving Janis chose to use for the phenomenon. The kind of flawed group dynamics that lets bad ideas go unchallenged by questions and disagreement, and can sometimes yield disastrous outcomes. Kennedy's top advisors were unwilling to challenge bad ideas because it might disturb perceived or desired group concurrence. Presidential advisor Arthur Schlesinger, for instance, presented serious objections to the invasion in a memorandum to the president, but suppressed his doubts at the team meetings. Everyone assumed other members agreed with the invasion plan. Schlesinger later lamented, "In the months after the Bay of Pigs, I bitterly reproached myself for having kept so silent during those crucial discussions in the cabinet room," he continued. "I can only explain my failure to do more than raise a few timid questions by reporting that one's impulse to blow the whistle on this nonsense was simply undone by our inability to challenge one another and ask questions." Day-to-day disaster prevention. Questions and a questioning attitude are not just important for avoiding historic disasters. They are also useful day in and day out for giving feedback, problem solving, strategic planning, resolving conflicts, team building, and more. When we avoid questions, all these activities suffer, even if they don't lead to disasters of historic proportions. Consider what Cindy Stewart, president and CEO of the Family Health Council of Central Pennsylvania, told me. "One of the first jobs that I had was in a sewing factory. My job title was floor girl, which was the assistant to the floor lady. No kidding. This job entitled moving work from one process to another to ensure that none of the workers in your section were without work, and that specific garment lots would be completed by the deliverable date. It was not considered a management position. I distinctly remember overhearing the management team discussing a particular bottleneck that routinely occurred with this one style of nightgown. As they wrestled with solutions, none of which worked, I can clearly recall that I was thinking, I wish they would ask me. Since I was the one who worked the closest to the problematic process, I felt I was in the best position to solve the problem. Of course, they never did ask me." In avoiding questions, the management team at that sewing factory closed off a potentially important source of ideas and information, and its problem-solving abilities suffered as a result. The experience left a lasting impression on Stewart. "I think I made up my mind at that time that if I were ever to be in a leadership position, I would never assume that having the title would mean that I had all the answers. Over my 20-plus years in executive positions, I have come to realize that much of my success can be attributed to the fact that I believe in the capacity of the people who have worked with me. I truly think that the leader who tries to know it all and tells everyone what to do is doomed to failure." Facing reality. "No company can become great," Jim Collins tells us in Good to Great, "without the ability to confront the brutal facts of reality and to ask questions. The failure to ask questions, in other words, allows us to operate with a distorted sense of reality. In fact, Sidney Finkelstein calls companies that are unable to question their prevailing view of reality zombies. A zombie company, he says, is a walking corpse that just doesn't know yet that it's dead. because this company has created an insulated culture that systematically excludes any information that could contradict its reigning picture of reality. But as GE's former CEO Jack Welch says, leading successfully means seeing the world the way it is, not the way we hope it will be or wish it will be. Those responsible for the Bay of Pigs, the Challenger disaster, and the sinking of the Titanic were all operating under a distorted picture of reality because they failed to ask questions. Organizations and leaders who avoid questions are actually losing opportunities to learn, according to Noel Tishy. This is not a trivial issue. Many executives close off learning. In their day-to-day interactions with staff, they are usually either issuing instructions or making judgments about the ideas or performance of others. By telling rather than asking, Tishy says, they are actually making their organizations dumber, less smart, less aligned, and less energized every day. In such organizations, there is little or no knowledge transfer. Intelligence is assumed to reside at the top, and everyone below senior management is expected to check their brains at the door. Mike Parker, president and CEO of Dow Chemical, notes, "A lot of bad leadership comes from an inability or unwillingness to ask questions. I have watched talented people, people with much higher IQs than mine, who have failed as leaders. They can talk brilliantly, with a great breadth of knowledge, but they're not very good at asking questions. So while they know a lot at a high level, they don't know what's going on way down in the system. Sometimes they are afraid of asking dumb questions, but what they don't realize is that the dumbest questions can be very powerful. They can unlock a conversation." Questions as the ultimate leadership tool. Many years ago, in his best-selling classic, How to Win Friends and Influence People, Dale Carnegie noted that an effective leader asks questions instead of giving orders. Ed Oakley and Doug Krug call questions the ultimate empowerment tool for the leader. They observe that the better we as leaders become at asking effective questions and listening for the answers to those questions, the more consistently we and the people we work with can accomplish mutually satisfying objectives, be empowered, reduce resistance, and create a willingness to pursue innovative change. John Cotter, a Harvard professor and author on many books on leadership, writes that the key difference between leaders and managers is that leaders focus on getting to the right questions, whereas managers focus on finding solutions to those questions. The focus on finding answers must not obscure the importance of asking the right questions. Successful leaders know that they cannot get the right answer without asking the right questions. Peter Drucker found that effective executives all tended to do the following. They asked, "What needs to be done?" They asked, "What is right for the enterprise?" They developed action plans. They took responsibility for decisions. They took responsibility for communicating. They were focused on opportunities rather than problems. They ran productive meetings. They thought and said we rather than I. They listened first, spoke last. Questions are at the heart of each of these practices. As Beverly Kay and Julie Winkle Giuliani note, a leader does not have to have all the answers, but what is not negotiable is not being willing or able to ask questions. The ability to ask questions effectively is one of a leader's most important tools. Donald Peterson, former CEO of Ford Motor Company, once remarked, "Asking more of the right questions reduces the need to have all the answers." In our interviews with successful leaders, we found a similar willingness to express ignorance and an equal respect for the power of questions. Consider these remarks from Douglas Eden, president of Cargill's Malt Americas division. "When I came back from my assignments overseas and was appointed president of Malt Americas, I was asked to make critical changes as the business was failing. We had to quickly decide whether to stay in or exit, and if we stayed in, what changes would be necessary to make the business viable. I did not consciously make a decision to become a questioning leader, but it began to naturally occur as I had lots of questions and had to search for answers. Should we remain an efficient, low-cost supplier, or should we become the premier solution provider to the brewery business? What would be of most value to brewmasters? Technical solutions such as better foam and flavor, or supply chain solutions? I was new to the brewer's malt business and naturally had lots of questions. Some of the staff wanted me to be more directive and to tell them how to execute various tasks. I really did not know immediately what to do and was not ready to immediately propose strategies. Some were more comfortable with this approach than others. As we all got better at asking questions of each other, we generated solutions that led to longer-term contracts and more value to our customers. Now, 4 years later, we are a more successful business. I attribute much of this success to our ability to ask questions. Our business is very complex, and we have to search for the answers together. Both Peterson and Eden were willing to say, "I don't know," and to ask questions and work with others to find answers. As Collins tells us, leading from good to great does not mean coming up with answers and then motivating everyone to follow your messianic vision. It means having the humility to grasp the fact that you do not yet understand enough to have the answers, and then to ask the questions that will lead to the best possible insights. Another example of a leader who makes effective use of questions is Commander D. Michael Abrashoff, through what he calls grassroots leadership. Commander Abrashoff turned around the operations of the USS Benfold, of the U.S. Navy's most modern warships. His methods were not complex, yet the results were astounding. Under Abrashoff's 20-month command, the Benfold operated on 75% of its allocated budget, returning $1.4 million to the Navy coffers. During that time, the ship's combat readiness indicators were the highest ever in the history of the Pacific Fleet. The promotion rate of his people was 2.5 times the Navy average. The pre-deployment training cycle, which usually takes a total of 52 days, was completed by the Benfold crew in just 19 days. During a 12-month period under the previous command, there were 28 disciplinary actions for which 23 sailors were discharged. During Abrashoff's tenure, there were 5 disciplinary cases and no discharges. Under his predecessor, 31 people were detached from the ship for limited duty, usually for complaints of bad backs. He had only 2 crew members leave for health reasons. A third of all recruits don't make it through the first term of enlistment, and only 54% of sailors stay in the Navy after their second duty tour. Commander Abrashoff had 100% of the Benfold's career sailors signing on for another tour. It is estimated that his retention alone saved the Navy $1.6 million in 1998. What did he do to stage such a turnaround in less than 20 months? As he himself remarks, he continuously asked questions, he listened, and then he acted on what he heard. Almost immediately upon taking command, he had a 15 to 20 minute personal interview with each of his staff of 300. He asked each person these 3 questions. What do you like best about this ship? What do you like least? What would you change if you could? Abrashoff acted as quickly as he could to implement the ideas that came from these questions. He realized that simply following existing procedures and doing things the way they had always been done could no longer be effective. He set the vision and trusted his crew and helped people take pride in their work. Whenever I didn't get the results I was looking for on the Benfold, I tried to look inward before flying off the handle. I also asked myself 3 questions each time. Did I clearly articulate the goals I was trying to achieve? Did I give people the time and resources they needed to succeed? Did I give them enough training to get the job done properly? 80% of the time I found that I was part of the problem, and that through my actions alone, I could have altered the outcome significantly. Abrashoff questioned every rule. He noted that when an officer or sailor came to him for approval or a signature on something, his first question was always, "Why do we do it this way?" If the answer was, "Because this is the way it's always been done," I would say, "That's not good enough. Find out if there is a better way to do this." After a while, people began doing their homework before they ever brought issues to me. And they would explain, "This is why we do things this way," or, "We've thought of a better way to get this accomplished." It drove my officers crazy. But by creating a culture in which we questioned everything, we were training our people to keep their eyes open to new ways of doing business. Great questions define great leaders. Google recently conducted a research survey of over 80,000 managers called Project Oxygen to determine what makes the most effective leaders great leaders. In this study, they identified 10 traits that were most common among the most effective leaders. The number one trait was asking questions and listening. Asking rather than telling, questions rather than answers, has become the key to leadership excellence and success in the 21st century. Peter Drucker, considered the leadership guru of the 20th century and still going strong, notes that the leader of the past may have been a person who knew how to tell, but certainly the leader of the future will be a person who knows how to ask. With the growing complexity and speed of change in the world, the traditional hierarchical model of leadership that worked yesterday will not.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.